my gosh. What? That was awesome. Who knew they made a Brother Herb video game? It's weird. So any that might be available for download later. So just be paying attention for that. Welcome to our midweek service at North Jacksonville Baptist Church. We're super excited to have you here, whether you join us in person or online. We're really glad to have you. If you get a chance and you're visiting with us, there is a Connect card right in front of you in the in your pew. You can fill that out and drop it in one of the silver boxes on your way out or at the Connect desk. That allows us as a staff to pray for you, to be able to get in contact with you, answer any questions that you may have. If you have come ready to give your offering, there's three ways that you can do that. You can do it through our giving kiosk, you can do it online, or you can stop by and drop it in one of those silver boxes. It has been a wild, energetic week at our church this week, and it is going to be a wild, energetic night tonight. And so if you came tonight thinking this is a normal Wednesday night, man, you are in for a treat, a surprise. We have had high energy. The staff, oh my gosh, why'd the name just jump right out of my mouth? For Freestyle has been here all week long, Freestyle people. And so they're joining us tonight. So I want to draw your attention to our prayer sheet tonight before we get started to let you know of some of the prayer needs within our church. Be praying for Brad Silas. He is in UF Health Gainesville. Ezra McKinley is also over in Gainesville. A couple of people who've been visiting the church, some non-members, John Hilling and Buddy Mosley. But we've lost some significant people in our church family this week, so you need to be praying for them. Miss Beverly Sharp passed away this past weekend, and very active in our children's ministry, and just an incredible lady. And so pray for her family. Philip Lowry and Gary Tomlinson passed away this weekend. If you're going, is that the same guy who sang? Yeah, it is. And so we pray for him and his family. So I'm going to ask Trey to come up and lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for the moment that we have to gather together tonight. Thank you for what this room represents, the multi-generations that are in this room, Lord, that have gathered to sing your praise, to honor you, Lord. We thank you for all the fun that we've had this summer, Lord, and the memories that have been made through this family scoreboard. Lord, I pray that as we gather together, we will just come into this room to celebrate what you've done in our lives, what you've done in our families. But we also come together mourning with our church family tonight. So many have lost loved ones and have others in the hospital. Lord, I pray that in these moments, in these darkest days, Lord, that you would be their guide, you'd be their comfort, and you'd help us as a church to come around them and support them and to point them back to you. Lord, we thank you once again for this moment and just what you're doing in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please turn your attention to the baptistry.
This is Adeline Havener. Adeline, based on your profession of faith and in obedience to Christ's command, it is my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism, amen. Raised again to new life in Christ. This is Eloise Prescott. Eloise, based on your profession of faith and in obedience to Christ's command, it is my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism, raised again to new life in Christ.
You ready? Can we do
ready.
This? Okay, here we go. Oh, we're good. Okay. Well, we're excited to be here. I'm Miss Kelly. I'm the kids director, and this is
Myra Campbell, director of preschool.
And we are gonna play a game with you guys. So, hope you did your stretches. Everyone, stand up. And here is how we play. Miss Myra and I are gonna go through a list of 15 things. And if you have done that, you stay standing. If you have not done that, you are out. Sit down. And you cannot get back in the game. Do know that the Lord is watching and do not cheat. You ready? Okay, you're going with number one.
You sing in the shower.
So if you sing in the shower, stand up. You're awesome. If you do not, you should try it. Have a seat.
You're not wearing socks.
Okay. Well, okay, number two is?
You're not wearing socks.
So you're not wearing socks. Okay. Oh, that wiped out a bunch. Okay, number three.
All right, you have purposely eaten a bug.
If you have eaten a bug, stay standing. And we're all watching to see who ate a bug. Okay. Okay. Do know that if you are still standing at the end of the game, you do get a prize. Tonight at the end of the service, we have our ice cream truck. And so if you are still standing at the end of the game, you get to go first. So here we go. Next one, number five.
You didn't eat a Wednesday night meal in July.
If you did not eat a delicious meal in July, sit down. And shame on you, because it was really good. Okay.
You don't have a North Jax t-shirt.
If you haven't visited our bookstore and bought some swag, sit down. Okay, here we go.
You're the firstborn child.
Man.
All these firstborns.
You don't have any pets.
Stay standing if you have got zero pets. Do we have anyone still in the game? Okay. Oh, so no, Savannah's mom told her to sit down. You do not have any pets. Yeah, so, oh, Mr. Ed in the back. Oh,
I'm still standing. Up top.
Up top. Oh, go, Mr. McClunk's coming in. Okay, here we go.
You'd rather have barbecue than ice cream.
Oh, that's, I'll pray for you. Okay. Okay, here we go.
You can play an instrument.
So if you can play, stay up. If you cannot, okay.
Yay.
So we got one in the balcony, two in the balcony.
Anybody downstairs?
Oh, Miss Hartley coming in. Here we go.
You've never sang in the choir. Uh-oh.
Wait. Is there anyone still standing? That.
Does kids choir count?
I would. I accept kids choir. Okay, we're gonna keep going.
Where are we? You're more likely to visit McDonald's than Chick-fil-A.
And we are gonna watch you. Andy, how could you even put that? That's. Okay. Wait. This.
You were born in June, July, or August.
I think that's it. I think everyone's out.
Well,
we're still standing. Were you born in June, July, or August?
I was not.
I wasn't either. So I think we all get ice cream. You guys all won. Way to play. Great job. Okay. Oh, we got a video.
That's the last time we get on this.
Lord, for the small things like me and her on a porch swing, for summer nights and fireflies and the sound of my old six string. Blessings on blessings on blessings on blessings. If I still got breath in these lungs, then that's all I need to get down on my knees and be thankful for all that he's done. For my mama, for my friends, for your love that never ends, for the times, for lighting the way in the dark times, for pulling me in, for giving again the times that I took it too far. I gotta thank you for keeping me humble, for picking me up when I stumble. And although I change, you stay the same, and I don't say thank you enough. For my mama, for my friends, for your love that never ends, for the songs that make us dance on this old dirt floor. For my babies, for my girl, for the way they change my world. Yeah, I just gotta say thank you, Lord. I just wanna say thank you, Lord. Oh, yeah. Praise up, eyes closed. One thing I know. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise up, eyes closed. One thing I know. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
It has been an awesome summer celebrating our families, and we are so thankful for that. Thank you to our family ministries, to Brother Andy, Miss Kelly, Miss Myra, Brother Trey, for putting all this together. But it's been an incredible summer, and so just give it up for them. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, guys. All right. Getting you back on your feet again. Everybody standing up? And here's what you're going to do. Kids, you're going to help me teach it to them. And some of you old rockers out there, you're going to recognize this, but what you're going to do is you're going to go stomp, stomp, clap, 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 stomp, stomp, clap. I know what's going on in some of your minds, all right? I know it. I know, but y'all need to get saved. But anyway, all right, good. Now, hold on. It's fixed to start, and we're going, when they start this video, this is Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, Wiki Wah. All right, let her roll.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones who in
Adults, I'm going to ask you to be seated. Now, it's kind of like this game Miss Kelly played. As they start the music again, you play a little bit lower. First of all, Kids Praise Choir kicks off next Wednesday night. Big kickoff, lots of prizes, lots of fun. You don't want to miss that. If you are a parent of one of these, stand up so your kids can find you. They're coming to you. Parent, kids, look out there, find your parents. They all sit in the same place every week. So go. See them. All right. Wave at your kids. You can wave at your kids. It's legal. All right. No strays. They're all yours, Brother Andy.
Oh, my gosh. That's so much fun. This is a sweet time, and that's a really if you can't smile after watching that, it's you. You're the problem. So Psalm 133 is where we're going to be tonight as we kind of finish up this series on the family. And I want to thank Kelly and Trey and Myra and all the work that they put in to help pulling off this summer. And thank Brother Herb and Brother Josh and Brother Trey for preaching this and really just going in on this this subject, and everybody who led worship. And it's been a really good summer in the life of our church. I also want to thank the people who submitted pictures. We had we had over 50 family units that sent in pictures for the summer scoreboard. And so I know you've been busy. It's been great because there's so many of you that I don't know personally, but I've really kind of gotten to live through your summer looking at your pictures. And so it's been really good. And this summer, what we've tried to do is talk about how to build a healthy family and what it takes to build a healthy family. And we said that it's built by God. The second thing we said, that it starts with a good marriage. We said it has a cycle of success, and it's wise in the way they relate to one another. And tonight, we wrap it up with this. A healthy family does things together. When Stephanie and I were younger, there were nights that we would just collapse into bed, exhausted from the day, from the week we had just finished. And inevitably in our conversation, we would say something like this: maybe next week we'll slow down a little bit. And I'm happy to tell you, we've now celebrated approximately 20 years of having that conversation. And it's not happened yet. And right, yeah, that's right. And so it's foolish that we thought, as our kids would get up older, that life would slow down. And that's not what we found. In fact, we found the extreme opposite, because everybody's got social calendars that they got to go and take care of things. They've got obligations. They've got work schedules. We've got obligations that fill up our calendar. And I know that we're not alone in this. I know we're all increasingly finding ourselves more and more disconnected and fighting to do things together, because we live in this world of multiple schedules and directions. When social opportunities and obligations fill up our calendar, where we spend more time at the ballpark than we do at the dinner table. And when we say more to each other through text than we do face to face. We are increasingly more disconnected as family. And so I wanted to read this psalm out of Psalm 133. And so let's all stand together as we honor the reading of God's word. Psalm 133. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when the brothers dwell in unity. It's like a precious oil on the head running down the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down the collar of his robes. It's like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Father God, we pray your blessing on this night tonight, and your blessings on this family. God, as you have declared a blessing in this psalm on the family that is united together. God, we We pray your blessings on our night. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're, this song, or this psalm is, again, it's part of this group of psalms that are called the Psalms of the Ascent, which we said last time was basically a playlist that as these families would travel from wherever they were coming from into Jerusalem to celebrate these feasts, they would sing these songs over and over again. And so, as of course, as I've prepared this, I'm watching these kids sing this song tonight. There's so much of this, they have no idea what they're singing. They're singing words to a rhythm, but they don't know really what it means to be walking through a storm of life, and the only thing that you've got at that time as a weapon is praise to God. That at that moment, you're going to lift a hallelujah. They're singing Honey in the Rock, and they don't know what that means, but we're putting this in them over and over and over again so that when they get to the place where they do understand, these are truths that are deeply embedded into their minds and hearts. It's this earworm that gets in, and they're singing in the back of the car as you're traveling back and forth wherever you're running to, and they're singing these truths over and over again as it gets implanted into their hearts and into their lives. So we see this this song of the ascent. Family is God's design, and He has put it together not only for the spreading of His truth in His word, but also as this giant object lesson of how we are supposed to be relating to each other, and how what our relationship is to look like with Him, and what His family, God, the tribes of Israel, which are the names of the sons of Jacob, they would all travel in together to join in these celebration, like going to Thanksgiving and eating and laughing and celebrating. And God gives them this plan, and He says this right at the beginning: how good and pleasant it is when the brothers dwell in unity. And God's watching His family kind of come together to celebrate these feasts. And so I don't know if you've ever had this moment where as your family's all together, and there's chaos, and there's wrapping paper being thrown up in the air, or there's, bones from eating turkeys or whatever, however you celebrate, and you just have this moment where you just kind of sit back and look and go, man, this is awesome. This is what family should be, and this is what it's supposed to look like. And so I kind of picture God doing that, sitting back going, man, all of my family's together, and they're celebrating together. This is good, and it's pleasant. It's good and pleasant when the brothers are in unity. And God loves when we're together, not just geographically, because we can come together and not be unified. We can sit into this place and not be of one heart and one mind. We can sit in our homes and be in the same house and not be unity. But when we choose to love over our opinions, when we choose grace above judgment, then we can have this unity and not uniformity, but we can be what the family of God is intended to be. And when we are, it is good and it is pleasant. And it goes beyond that. He says this in verse 2. It's like precious oil on your head. And so when the priests were anointed with oil, and we know that this is the priest because it's the line of Aaron, which he refers to in this verse, they were anointed with oil. It's not like there was a couple of little drops that got put on. It was poured all over. In fact, this verse says it just ran down his beard and onto his robe, creating a fragrance that everyone around found pleasant. Now, this is not a call for you to go home and bathe in deodorant or cologne or Axe body spray, whatever is your thing. But we all know, we're in Florida, right? This is honest talk. We all know what it's like to be around somebody who has expired, right? We've all been that person. Ain't nobody want to be around that person. But I also know what it's like to walk by somebody and they've just fresh out of the shower, and you go, ooh, they smell clean. He just kind of gets, and so this is what this psalm is saying here, is that when the brothers exist in unity, not only is it pleasant and good, it's like a beautiful fragrance that affects the world around. They can't help but to notice. When there's, and I know you've done this, you've sat in the restaurant before and you've watched that sweet little family over there and you're just watching them like a weird, creepy person. But you're just sitting there and go, man, what a sweet family. And it does something in your heart. And you don't think the world's watching, not just our families as they go from this place, but our church family and how we operate together. So family who is together is a sweet, pleasant fragrance to the world that's around. Verse 3 says this. It's like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. This is a picture of refreshment. Now, at least two times a year, when they would travel over, they were traveling over during summer months. And if there's one thing that we understand in Florida, it's hot. And there's days where you should not go out at 7 o'clock in the morning and drink the air. That's not natural. Much less being in the middle of the day. And God bless all you people who are working out of this, working in this day in and day out. And some days you just want refreshment. And so as they would travel, they're looking up and they're seeing this this mountain that was full of greenery. And as the rain would fall and the dew would fall, it provided refreshment during the hottest part of the year as it would run down to the valley where the people were. And so he says a unified family is refreshing, again, not for just your family, for the people that are around you. This idea of refreshment is symbolic of the Holy Spirit that extends from us, influencing way beyond what you believe your reach to be. And so this summer, not only did we want you to take a hard look at your family and what it takes to build a healthy family within your four walls, but we wanted to kind of draw the illustration and the connection of how your marriage is not just for you. You have the opportunity to have a generational impact. How you as grandparents cannot just change your family tree, but continue to affect how your generations were going to be. How love and respect practiced in the home transfers to how we treat all of our relationships, including the ones we have with God. And for us to understand that togetherness is God's design. And so there's togetherness in His family. There's a bigger picture in mind than just the idea of our families, but God's family. And those principles are the same in both. So here's what I want to give us as we close out this summer. There are three things that all healthy families do. And so we're going to kind of go through this because we've got kids in here and we've got ice cream waiting for us. So buckle up. Here we go. The first thing is healthy families worship together. Healthy families worship together. The Bible tells us in Hebrews not to forsake the assembling of ourselves. In fact, that verse even continues on and says, as some have done. And he says that because this is what we do. We take all of this for granted. The opportunities that we have to worship together as a greater family and as your family. We take that for granted and we forsake that. But to worship together unifies your family. For a couple of hours a week, for the most part, there's no cell phones. Those things are turned off unless you forget, right? You're not in front of the TV. You don't have any appointments going on. You're just here together for one purpose, the worship of God. this pause in your week not only helps you connect to the creator of the universe, but helps you to connect each other. Because this is what we were designed to do. We're designed to have a spiritual connection with each other. So it unifies your family. It encourages meaningful conversation. We spend an enormous amount of time talking about meaningless things. We talk about schedule. We talk about homework. We talk about entertainment choices. But worship, when we're here together, we're talking about God. We're talking about deep things. We're talking about real things. What God's doing in us and how He's teaching us and how He's growing us. It opens up the deeper parts of who you are when you're having spiritual conversations with your family. And what they're learning in the preschool department, what they're learning in the children's department. I know a lot of times you get in the car and you go, well, what was your lesson on today? And that's about as deep as we dig. And we don't find out really what's going on in the hearts of our kids. And our kids are certainly not asking us what's going on in our hearts. And we're not having some of those deep conversations. But we're supposed to be doing that everywhere we go. That's why Deuteronomy says, talk about these things when you wake up, when you go to sleep, while you're walking around. Like, this should be such a natural part of our conversations. The depth and the spiritual element of what we're talking about, what we're learning in worship. It also creates spiritual traditions. Traditions are a big part of a family's identity, and we all have them, right? Your tradition might be some school colors, and this is what we do on Saturdays. Your traditions might be some weekend events or weekend hobbies, and this is what we do. We get in the tree on Saturday. We're out on the lake on this. This is who we are. This is our identity. This is what we do on birthdays. This is what we do at Christmas. This is what we do on vacations. Traditions hold generations together. And they develop into an emotional anchor that holds your family fast in the storms of life. And a family who makes I get traditions can get stale if you lose the depth and meaning of that. But the fact is that a family who makes worship a priority and creates a tradition of doing this every Sunday, at some point in time, whether your kids go astray or not, when the storms of life hit, the anchor that they've put down is going to draw them back to a place, if not this place, to say, no, this is what we do. This is who we are. This is what our family is about. So not only do healthy families worship together, healthy families serve together. And there's some benefits to serving together. It bonds your family. Most of you know I was a youth pastor here for 18 years. What most of you don't know is the enormous amount of planning that went on at our house. We were having conversations around the dinner table about events, and we could do this, and we would laugh together. I've listened to my kids talk about when it came to camp, spending nights at home cutting out gigantic styrofoam puzzle pieces and tying ropes together. My kids have put out more forks and spoons on table than anybody in this place. And what for me was just please help desperation. We fell into this amazing thing of service that we did together as a family that united us and drew us together, and we spent time together. It created core memories. I was having a conversation with Nathan not long ago and really kind of apologized in some ways, going, man, I hope growing up, I know I spent a lot of time kind of focusing on those things, but we had a camp one time, and it just, for whatever reason, it just ended up being he and I at camp, and he was a little guy, man, and he's like, that's the greatest week of my life. It was a core memory for me. Like, I had no idea, And so you don't realize the impact of what it's doing in your life when you decide to to be involved in some level of service as a family. We get outside of our comfort zones. We grow personally, and you grow as a family. You're, as individuals, your mentality grows. It leads to a stronger family dynamic, and exposing your family to service makes you a better parent because you're learning to serve too. And you're showing them how to serve. And so all the lessons that they're learning, you're learning along with them. So it bonds your family. It deepens your love for one another. You cannot serve without love. And when you choose to serve, you choose to open your heart in ways that we don't normally do on an everyday basis. You learn to let go of stereotypes. You learn to let go of your preconceived notions and mental filters that affect how you see people. These are not those people. These are people created in the image of God that we have the opportunity to serve. And sometimes it's here, sometimes it's across the planet. And when you get to open up your heart in that way, it doesn't just stay there. You learn to love your kids in ways that you did not know how to love them before because now you see them as image bearers of God. When you surrender yourself and commit to getting to know people and their stories and their situations and their needs, you open up the door to truly love them with all your heart, and it increases this capacity and perspective that you have to love people, and that door opens naturally and it transfers into the people in your house. And your kids to learn to love each other and love you in ways that are outside of those walls. Serving also heals wounds. There's something about serving that brings about healing. It's the positive feelings. You know, a lot of times when we're going through difficulties in life, and you're struggling with anxiety or you're struggling with depression and you're struggling with all of these mental disorders, you can trace it back to this. There's a lot of focus on you. And the way out of that, stop focusing on you so much and start serving and giving out of who you are. You begin to get some perspective. You realize that the major problems that you have in your life really aren't that major. Your family gets to spend quality time together. It helps with perspectives. Spouses begin to realize that the things that they're arguing over is really not that big of a deal. Brothers and sisters who feel like they're hating each other recognize that there's blessings in caring about each other. Parents understand the issues between them and their children aren't so bad, that things can be worked through. Healing happens on all levels when you commit to serve. But finally, a healthy family has fun together. It makes life pleasurable. One of my favorite verses, I love that Jesus says, I came to give life abundantly. Like, this life is not supposed to be boring. I don't think Jesus was boring. I don't think he walked around all the time with just the stone, you know, faceless, emotionless expression. And he was fun to be around. I think there was a lot of laughter that happened. Life can suck the life out of what life is supposed to be. Life is hard, but when the possibility to have fun, it turns the hardships of life into abundant life. I tell a story. I didn't ask this lady, but I'm telling it anyway. One of the joys of the emails that I got was people would give their descriptions of some of the pictures that they would send in for the summer scoreboard. And so there's this picture of one family. And this lady had, you could tell she's in the medical field. And she said it had been a long day. It had been a hard day. The last thing that she wanted to do, like get home and be mom. And so what was the antidote to all of the hardship? Grab a walk. What was the, I don't know. What was the antidote to the hardships? Grab a water gun and start shooting your kids. I'm like, oh my gosh. And they're laughing. And listen, before you think that you go, oh, that's sweet. They're doing that. These were teenagers. And the teenagers were smiling and laughing and didn't have phones in their hands. This is what fun brings into a family. It makes life pleasurable. It creates an emotional connection. This is why advertisers use humor. They know that there's a connection that what happens in life when we laugh and when we have fun. You go through thousands of moments with your family. The ones that your kids are going to be talking about years from now are the ones that are going to start with, hey, do you remember that time? And it's going to be laughter, and it's going to be fun, because fun created that memory, and it created an emotional connection that they're hanging on to. Fun also resets our priority. We worry about a bunch of useless things. And I know that I've put fun on hold because of something I had to get done, right? I know that I've looked at my kids and said, I can't right now, I'm too tired, kiddo. And then I got sick. And all of a sudden you go, why am I worried about all this stuff? Like, why is this such a big deal? You know what I never thought about? I never thought about all this. I didn't think about the yard. I didn't think about the projects in the house that needed to get done. I didn't care about any of that stuff. I thought about the fun times I had with my family. I thought about laughing. I thought about vacations. I thought about memories. I thought about the beach. I thought about watching my family enjoy each other, and it makes you step back and prioritize your life. And there's a lot of stuff that you're burdened with right now. It's not a big deal. Set that stuff aside. Put some fun into your day and into your life. Fun dispels bitterness and anger and resentment and aggression. James tells us that we do things that, why, what was the source of the quarrels and the angst among you? Is it not the passions and the lust that raise up inside of us? Is it not the selfishness that we have? When we choose fun, we're choosing to put all of those things aside. And the last thing is, it redeems bad memories. Listen, we've had some, like, fantastic parenting moments. And when I say that with a heavy dose of sarcasm. We've done a lot of things that our kids are going to talk to their therapist about one day. But I believe when they're together as adults and they're all sitting around with their kids and they're talking about how nuts their parents were, the overwhelming conversation is not going to be that. It's going to be the fun times we had together. It's going to overshadow all of those. I know you're like, I'm trying to nail it as a parent, and I'm failing miserably. It's okay. It's okay. Then you just need to interject more fun. You need to put more of that into your life, because those are the moments that are going to overshadow all those moments that we wished we had back. So I want to close with this, because I know this is not everybody's story. I know everybody's in a different place, but as I was talking with Kelly one day about kind of the outline of this this message tonight, she said, you know what, this really should be something that it frameworks what we do as a church with our families, that we're going to worship together, that we're going to serve together, and that we're going to have fun together. And so this place, when you come, it's going to be all of that. We want your kids to have a good time, but we want your families to have a good time. We want meaningful worship that's going to draw you together so that you're leaving this place and having deep, real conversations. We're wanting you to put you into opportunities to serve, to not make this life about us, but to make it about others. And if you're here tonight, you're going, I don't feel like I'm a part of that kind of family. There's the beauty of all of this truth. There's plenty of room in God's family. Amen. And he sent his son to die on the cross for you, to make a way so that you can enter into a relationship with Him, so you can experience abundant life, so you can experience what it feels like to serve and be served, so you can experience this connection and this healing, so you can experience what it feels like to be in a real relationship and in a real family. So in just a minute, we're going to all stand together and we're going to pray. And if you're here tonight and you've never given your life to Christ, the invitation's open to be a part of what God's doing as He is inviting you into His family. Let's pray together. God, we thank You for this night that You've given us. And Lord, I pray that as we are growing in our individual families, God, we pray that you place these truths in our church family and ultimately, God, in Your family. God, if there's someone here tonight, God, I pray, Lord, Your Spirit speak directly to their heart. Draw them in to Your family. We love You and we thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll all stand together as the music plays, men are standing at the end of each aisle. I invite you down to come and speak to them, be a part of God's family.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory.
God is stirring tonight, and I believe that He's stirring in the hearts of our church. And so if you're here tonight, as people are coming down, some of you may just be going, I wish they would stop singing so I can go home. But God is speaking to you. So we're going to sing one more time. And if God's calling you, please come down and talk to one of these men as God's drawing you right now. Let's sing.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. And grace.
Awesome. You can be seated. We have got a couple of announcements that I need to go over, and we have got one big reveal to get to tonight. So first of all, the car show is our North Jackson car show is coming up, and we need a ton of volunteers. Brother Tim and Brother Gary are going to be meeting with the volunteers tonight right after the service. You have got time to swing by, get your ice cream, and then come to the fellowship hall. So if you're panicked about that, don't panic. He'll wait on you. So go ahead and get that. Brother David wanted me to announce a couple of things. The primetime hymn sing is going to be this Monday at 10 a.m. So make sure you're here for that, for the hymn sing. And he says this every time. You don't have to be a primetimer to come. If you got Monday off and you want to sing hymns, there is a place for you. There is a part to be sung, and so you can come and do that. And he wanted, they've got a primetimers have got a Myrtle Beach trip coming up in September. They have room for two people. So if you're available or if you're interested in that, contact Miss Debbie in the office. Continue to pray for Woodlands, the freestyle camp this week. We've got a couple of more days before that is over, so pray for them. The end of the week is grueling, and the service for Miss Beverly Sharp is this Saturday at 11 a.m. with visitation starting at 10, and so that'll be here this Saturday. Now, we started this summer. Some of you were here the Sunday morning. We showed this this video about the chicken limo and this contest that that we had. And so our families have been actively involved in a summer contest where they did these different events for points, and the winner gets a on a Sunday morning, where they're available, we'll, as a church family, be out and celebrate their victory as they win Winner Winner Chicken Dinner t-shirts on the way out, and they get into the chicken limo, where they will be taken to a nice chicken-themed restaurant, and they will enjoy a good good Baptist lunch of fried chicken. After that, there's some events that we have planned for them. We have a photographer scheduled. They'll take family pictures with that. And so, but the real prize, really, people, is the limo. So that'll be here, and you can be a part of that. And so what we're going to do, I'm going to call Miss Kelly, Miss Myra, and Brother Trey, if you want to come up. And we're going to hand out some prizes. And so I'm going to give you the top 10 families in and so the first of all, and everybody in the top 10 wins a prize. So finish number 10, Miss Kelly, actually, you can step down there because the Pecorex finished in 10th place. Congratulations, Miss Kelly, 10th place. In 9th place, I thought I saw them, the Tarkingtons, Ray and Brooke, if you've got a family representative that you would like to send down, we have a prize for you. In 8th place, the Helmies. If you're here tonight, Helmies, come on down. In 7th, do what? In 7th place, the Hardens, Tim and Ashley. Okay. All right, we've got their prize. In 6th place, the Bennetts, Kara and Nick and their family. In 5th place, the Hartensteins, who I will say, this is a little plug, and they're announced they're pregnant. That's how they announced their pregnancy through summer scoreboard. So big props on that, bonus points. In 4th place, the Nortons, Alan and Katarina. So now we get down to the top three. And so I'm going to call all three families down, stand on the stage where we will make this as unnecessarily dramatic as possible. So in no particular order, if the Owensbys, the Milsteads, and the Masons, if you will all come down, you are our top three finishers. Oh, thanks. All right. Perfect. Perfect. All right. So we get in place. Oh, Trey, here's what we do. Are y'all, huh? Oh, it got cut? Oh. Oh, okay. Okay. All right. All right, we got okay. Yeah, there we go. All right. So, all of you families, I have really enjoyed watching your summer journey together. All of you did some, oh, it's okay. I'm dragging it out for that's okay. Take your time. We're not in that kind of hurry. I will say this. Tonight, if you're interested, instead of going to YouTube or turning on the TV, you can go to the Owensby's Facebook page where they have a series of videos that will entertain you for your night. We really enjoyed that. So it was incredibly close. And y'all did so well, all of you did so well, and worked hard, very creative entertainment. All right, so the winner of this year's, the Milsteads! Yay! Congratulations, grand prize winners. So we will be contacting you with shirt sizes and available dates, and then we will make a big deal with Giant Chickens and the whole nine yards. Congratulations. Y'all give it up for the Milsteads and all of the rest of our top three finalists. Thank you so much. Y'all can have a seat. Thank you all for coming tonight. Thank you for all that you did this summer. There is ice cream available toward the fellowship hall, and you can head that way. Have a